So the third and last talk for today is from Peng He. He's a postdoc at the Sanger Institute, and he's going to talk to us about a high-resolution atlas of the developing fetal lung. You're on.
So thank you for inviting me to share our work on the fetal lung atlas. So before I start my talk, I'd like to thank my supervisors, John Marioni and Sarah Teichman, as well as Emma Rollins and Kirsten Meyer for starting this project and writing the grants, apparently. And also, I would like to thank all the other colleagues who contributed to this work and also supported for a lot of useful discussions and interpretation of the data. So the development of the lungs has two main branching networks of epithelial cells and the vasculature that has a lot of cell types forming. So our team is especially interested in the epithelial cell, epithelial tube, which progressively establish their identities. So to answer the questions, we collected samples that cover the whole process of branching and maturation from the week 5 to week 22 post-conception. In total, we collected 40 samples and sequenced 80,000 cells. And with a focus on the week 15 to week 22, where we also separated the distal regions and proximal regions for a higher resolution. So based on the data analysis, we can see most of the compartments that we expect to see in the fetal lung, which is vasculature, fibroblasts, and stromal cells plus the immune cells. And by zooming in with recursive clustering, we can altogether identify more than 140 cell types and cell states. So interestingly, among these novel subtypes and states that we can identify, we see a lot of novel or unexpected progenitors, including the immune progenitors in both the lymphoid and myeloid compartments, and the epithelial progenitors, where you can see here the multipotent tip progenitor cells. So these cell states are actually having the spatial dependence and also the temporal dependency, where you can see for the tip epithelial cells, as an example, they are separated based on their stage with different developmental potentials. Based on our spatial validation data, we finally can put them together onto the spatial context summarized in this diagram that you can find in my poster. So our atlas not only provides a detailed catalog of what you can find in terms of the cell types and cell states, but we also provide a guide for hunting for the important transcription factors that regulate the cell fate commitment. One of the interesting examples is that we identified two subtypes of neuroendocrine cells in the fetal lung, which is actually independently identified from Jason Dury and Cole Trapnell's group. So these two subtypes of neuroendocrine cells are separated by two key transcription factors, NeuroD1 and ASCL1. While ASCL1 is the conventional marker for NeuroD1, for the neuroendocrine cells, NeuroD1 marks a novel subtype there. So what's interesting is that NeuroD1 and ASCL1 also happen to be the two marker genes for the two types of small cell lung cancer. So we are very interested in whether they are really the key compartments, key regulators of the neuroendocrine cells. So we used the multipotent tip organoid cell system to overexpress these two transcription factors individually. And our preliminary results suggest that the ASCL1 and NeuroD1 overexpression individually can be sufficient to push the tip cells into the targeting the neuroendocrine subtypes. So this is telling us that we successfully identified two transcription factors that are potentially governing the lineage commitment for the differentiated cell types. And we are expanding this methodology to identify more regulators for the epithelial generation. So if you are interested in our work, you are welcome to come to our poster for further discussion. Thank you.